talk to us about your journey to WWE. This isn't even your first go round within the WWE system, but you have put in a ton of work in this business and sacrificed like so many have, but we don't hear a lot about where LA Knight came from. We know who you are. Tell us about what made you the way you are.
I should have been gone a long time ago.
When you thought you were out.
Right. I've been on the radar since 2004, believe it or not. If you remember the $1 Million Tough Enough, I was a runner up. I was chosen as an alternate. They chose 8 people for that. You remember that was the one that The Miz was on. I was chosen. So they chose 8 and then 2 alternates. I was one of those 2 alternates. Now I was given a card from one of the high level people there and just said, hey, keep in touch with us. I'm a 22-year-old kid. I had been wrestling for about a year at that point. I didn't know what the hell to do with that card. I had no idea. Right. So I'm holding on to this card and I'm just like, just put that away. And it just sat there for years and nothing ever happened until somebody that I was wrestling with in my own company where I'd started in Ohio had gotten a dark match. And I was like, what the hell? If he's getting a dark match, I can get a dark match. So I started ringing off the hook. I called WWE talent relations every hour on the hour until somebody picked up. And I was just like, how can I come and be an extra? But the one thing is, I never knew I'd ask for a job.
Right.
I didn't know how to ask straight up. It was like, I'd get the extra gig. I'd do the dark match. I'd have a match on Heat way back when that was a thing.
Yeah.
I had a dark match in 2008 and I shot myself in the foot after that. I showed up late second day. They invited me back after my match. They were very happy with it. I came back the next day. I had some stuff happening with a shoulder, but at the same time, I was like, well, I can't go in there, not pumped up. I got to go to the gym real quick. That ended up going too long. I got there an hour late and I couldn't get a phone answered for 2-3 years.
It's so wild though. I just want to add a little context to what you're talking about, because that was sort of the same time frame that I started coming up and I experienced. That's how you used to get booked. If you were on the independents and you wanted to step foot, KP, into WWE, there was no NXT. There was developmental, but it wasn't like the monster that right. It is now, where it's the factory in Orlando where you have everything you need. You used to have to call a phone number and hopefully whoever was working at talent relations would pick up and you would say, hey, I see you guys are going to be in Pittsburgh and Cleveland and Detroit and Chicago. Do you have anything? And they'd go, okay, we need you in Chicago next week. We have a spot. And from Pittsburgh, that's an 8-hour drive. It's costing me money, but guess what? I'm going to get into that building and you feel like a pariah. You don't know what's happening. And we still do, Kevin. If you notice backstage, we have the extra talent.
Yeah, of course.
That used to be us. All of us. LA's done it. I've done it. I mean, you ask everybody who's anybody from that time period, it was the most nerve-wracking thing in the world, because you sit in this locker room and you hope to LA's point.
What locker room? It was usually
true, depending on the building.
It was a hallway with some curtains or a broom closet.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, we were the unwanted redheaded stepchildren of the day, and you'd usually walk up and they'd pay you, and 99% of the time you didn't do anything. But sometimes, every once in a while, Val Venus needed somebody to get beat up. Mark Henry had to throw old SJK around the ring. Like, I've never experienced a human, but that was how you got your foot in the door. And it's very different from how it works in this day and age, where you can submit photos and videos online and there's a website and it's very, very organized. It was kind of the Wild West back then. So sorry to make that sidebar. I just want everybody to understand what it was like for that time.
But that's period. So true. And even it was even to a point, like the first couple of times I went there were some people who weren't even necessarily invited. But if you were a wrestler, you could kind of just show up. Mm-hmm. And so when I was at Championship Wrestling of Hollywood for about 3 years, Paul Bearer was my manager. Okay. And so as Percy Pringle. He had told me one time in 2012, because I couldn't get him to answer the phone for like 2-3 years because of me showing up late that one time. And he was like, they're going to be in Anaheim. Just go show up. You can go work out. I'm like, okay, screw it. Yeah, I'll do that. I got there. And after about 20 minutes, somebody came up to me and they were like, hey, I'm sorry. I don't think you're on the list. And I was like, I'm not. But I was told by Paul Bearer, just kind of show up, whatever. And he was like, yeah, we're not doing that anymore, da, 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 whatever. I'm like,
oh, man.
Cool. So then I had to get out of there. So it wasn't until, I think 2012, midway somewhere, I think there was a change in talent relations. And then it was like, finally, I got a response to an email and I was like, oh, I got somebody on the hook.
Yeah, with this one, yo.
Yeah. And honestly, the first response was just like, well, you know, we have a lot of guys that kind of fit your physical demographic. We're trying to broaden the pool. And I was like, he responded to me. No. Hold on. I was like, I understand you've got a lot of guys that fit my physical, blah, blah, blah. I was like, but you don't have a lot of guys that fit my talent package. Da, 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 you know, I'm going on. And he's like, okay, you got my attention. Are you available these days? And I'm like, all right, here we go. Because all I wanted was a tryout. Just give me a straight up real tryout. Let me ask for a job. Because it was like, finally, just as I'm approaching, what was this, 2012 or 2013, finally I knew how to ask. Before it was just like, if I go there, I show up as an extra, I show up to do background work, they're just going to notice me and be like, right. Hey, it's, you want a job?
It's like people that move to Hollywood and they just expect that somebody's going to discover them while they're waiting tables without going to the audition. You have to do the work.
I'm like Jean-Claude Van Damme just doing karate moves in my driveway, hoping something notices me.
Like what you hear? Catch full episodes of After the Bell on Spotify. Follow us now and never miss an episode.